Scripture. Let's begin with prayer. Father, thank you for the afternoon. Help us to understand the biblical principles of this doctrine of biblical prophecy. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's go over the quiz here. Bill, please read question number one and give an answer.
When do proponents of the mid-tribulation view believe the rapture occurs? Between the first 3.5 years and the last 3.5 years?
Mid-tribulational view between the middle. Got the pre-tribbers before, the mid-tribbers in the middle, post-tribbers after. And there's the pre-wrath view, which is kind of slightly past the middle part of it, but before the end of it. Question two, Mr. Warren, please.
The hermeneutic of the mid-tribulationist, after what event does the rapture take place? At the sounding of the seventh trumpet and the catching up of the two witnesses in Revelation 11.
That's right. So they think it's the seventh trumpet. They get their trumpets mixed up.
That has nothing to do with 3.5 years or anything? Mid-tribulation?
The seventh trumpet sounds at the 3.5 year mark.
Okay, thanks.
Or thereabouts.
According to their view.
In their hermeneutic. Okay. Yeah, according to their view. That's right, thank you.
Pentecost.
According to their view.
Right.
Okay.
Right. I know that part.
They're getting their trumpets mixed up, and that's why their view's all mixed up. We'll talk about more of their view in this chapter as well. Number three. It's starting to get them mixed up, right? Okay, number three, please.
According to the mid, it's my turn, right?
Yes.
According to the mid-tribulationists, who is seen on the earth after Revelation 4? The church is seen on
earth. Is it not seen, or who is it?
I don't know the answer.
According to the mid-tribulationists' view.
Right.
According to their view.
I have the answer right.
Okay. Yes, I know you do.
I don't know if that's.
Yeah, I probably have the question wrong.
No, the question.
But the answer is. In common with the post-tribulationists, the church is promised tribulation on the earth and is in need of purging that the scripture is seen on the earth after Revelation 4:1. So they think it's there because of this purging concept.
The first 3.5 years?
Yes. Number four, Tammy.
Who deny these distinction between Israel and the church? The mid-tribulationists and the post-tribulationists and the amillennialists and the post-millennialists.
Yes.
Everyone.
That's true.
Pre-millennialists.
They get the distinction between Israel. I think that they don't see the distinction. Question five. What is one method of interpretation the mid-tribulationists invoke? What type of interpretation do they invoke?
What type of interpretation?
Yes.
What
type of method? What's that?
Figurative
or spiritual?
Okay.
Spiritual and then sometimes figurative. They kind of go back and forth between the two of them. Mrs. Grummer, number six, please.
What aspect of the Book of Revelations do the mid-tribulation defenders believe are not characteristic of the wrath of God? Number six. The seal judgment and the trumpet judgment.
Yes, both the seals and the trumpets, they don't think that has anything to do with the wrath of God. And so, in a certain sense, they say the church is promised tribulation, but yet in another sense, they're saying that the seals and the trumpets are not demonstrating the wrath of God. Jacob, number seven. That's right. Number eight, Bill.
Of what do mid-tribulationists believe the trumpets mentioned in the book of Revelation are an outworking of Satan?
Outworking of Satan, that's right. Mr. Warren, number nine.
How long do mid-tribulationists, rapturists, believe the tribulation will last? Three and a half years.
3.5 years. Number 10, please, Mom.
One, explain about the mid-tribulations believe about Explain what the mid-tribulation should believe about the two parts of the 70th week of Daniel. Begins in the middle of the 7 years. Do they believe that they are related to unrelated to each other? Unrelated. I don't know. I had a hard time with a lot of these questions, so you could correct them.
Okay, are they related or not?
I said unrelated.
Okay. Now this is the mid-tribulationist. Okay. This is from page 185. The mid-tribulation view essentially divides the 70th week into two distinct or disassociated parts. So they're seeing there's a different way they divide it. And we're still calling the 70th week holy that the church may go through the first half. And it's different than the last half. So they think the church goes through the first half, Israel goes through the last half. Tammy, number 11, please.
According to Pentecost, what prevents us from dividing the tribulation into two unrelated parts? The period of Daniel's 70th week is always referenced in Scripture as one unit, not two parts.
Okay, so there's a unity of the 70th week of Daniel. We can't divide it. The mid-tribbers, they divide it. Anna, question 12. What observation does Pentecost make concerning the 144,000?
These are observations that Pentecost makes?
Yes, mm-hmm.
I suppose he makes observations that they are prophets that will show the gospel to others.
Well, that's the correct view. I mean, this is the
Pentecost view.
The Pentecost is making an observation. Pentecost is observing what the mid-tribbers believe.
Observation, not of the scripture, but of
regarding
their view.
What observation?
Oh, well, then would they say that they are the 144,000?
Well, the people. What Pentecost is observing? Okay, in part, what he's observing is that the 144,000 would be part of the church. If the church was on the earth during the first 3.5 years. Then, and this, of course, according to the mid-tribue, not according to the pre-tribue, but this is what they're saying. So, again, when you have failed to distinguish between Israel and the church, then when you have the church in the first 3.5 years and Israel in the second 3.5 years, and since the 144,000 appear in the first part of the 3.5 years, then, you know, that's going to, would that make them a part of a church? Pentecost is just wondering that. Mm-hmm. You see, they would be forced to actually take that position. They may or may not take that position, mid-tribbers. All right, Mrs. Grummer, question 13, please.
What object is universally used in Scripture to represent God's presence? I have the cloud and the fire.
Cloud and the fire, yes. We're learning about that in the book of Exodus, are we not? Jacob, number 14, please.
According to mid-tribulationists, what do the seven bowls describe? I had to get this question right. I don't know is what I got.
The outpouring of the wrath of God.
Oh.
According to the mid-tribulationists.
Yes.
On page 187.
Oh. Okay.
Bill, number 15.
At what point in Daniel's 70th week does Pentecost place both, one, the seals, and two, the trumpets? For one, the first half, and the second half for the number two.
The trumpets are number two, right?
What's the answer?
Good. He just gave it.
Oh, I thought you were asking a question.
Pardon me?
He gave the answer.
Bill gave the answer.
I wrote the last trumpet. I don't know if that's right.
Okay. This is talking about the. 15? This is number 15. It's talking about.
15.
The Book of Revelation talks about seals, trumpets, and bowls. That's what we're talking about here.
Okay.
On number 16, Bill. The question wasn't phrased right.
It was very interesting, his timeline.
Yes.
Pentecost's timeline for the seals and the trumpets.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
Mr. Warren, number 16.
What other method of interpretation do the students of the mid-tribulation rapture embrace when interpreting Revelation chapter 11 The allegorical method.
The allegorical method of interpretation.
Did I take my turn?
Can you go to number 17?
What same word does Harrison rest his argument upon in respect to the rapture? Last.
The word last, that's correct. Tammy, number 18, please.
How does these then compare the trumpet of 1 Corinthians 15:52 and the one of Revelation 11:15? The trumpet of 1 Corinthians 15:52 signals the end of an age, but not the last in a series of trumpets.
All right. And number 19, Anna, two-part question. Which trumpet is associated with blessing? And the second part, which trumpet is associated with judgment? This is, again, 1 Corinthians 15 and Revelation 11.
1 Corinthians 15 is blessing.
Okay.
And then the Revelation 11 would be the wrath.
Okay, that's good. Number 20, Mrs. Grummer.
What is the duration of the sound, the trumpet? What is the duration of the sound, the trumpet of 1 Thessalonians? And then the second one versus the duration of the sound of the last trumpet in Revelation. Okay. I got number 20. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm lost. Number one, in Thessalonians, the trumpet sounds in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, and number two, the trumpet shall sound over a continued period of time.
That's good. So one is a twink, one's a quick, twinkling of eye, and the other one's a duration during the time of that judgment. Jacob, number 21, please.
With whom is God distinctly dealing in 1 Thessalonians? Only the church.
Just the church, that's right. Bill, number 22.
According to Pentecost, who will not be left behind at the rapture and experience the fear of Revelation 11:13? The prophets, the Old Testament.
There's not going to be a believing remnant left behind.
That's referring to of the church, right?
This is according to Pentecost. This is in the proper view.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
In the church.
No believing remnant of Christians.
No believing remnant of Christians are going to be left behind.
Not of Israelites.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's correct.
Because there will be a remnant of Israel,
yes,
in the tribulation. Mm-hmm. But that's different.
Well, if there were believing Jews left, they wouldn't be Jews. I mean, they'd still be physically Jews, but they'd be part of the church.
That's right. That's right.
Or anybody else, for that matter, not just Jews.
Mr. Warren, number 23, please.
When do those in the church receive their rewards? Following the rapture in the air.
And, the rapture, you get the judgment, you get the rewards, right? Number 24, Ron.
According to Armadine, what will be the final note struck just prior to the rapture? The last trump.
Last trump. And 25, Tammy?
What does not stand the examination of true interpretation of Scripture, the mid-tribulation rapture position?
The mid-tribulation rapture position, that's the quiz. So we have here the next section, next chapter. We're talking about the pre-tribulation rapture. Now, again, the rapture is taken away. The rapture is when the church, the body of Christ, God will call them up to the clouds to meet the Lord Jesus Christ in the air. That's could be sometimes be called phase one of his second coming, when we meet the Lord in the air. Phase two of the second coming, sometimes referred to the second coming proper, is when the Lord Jesus Christ actually returns to the earth physically, places his feet down the Mount of Olives, as we see there in Zechariah chapter 14. Now, the basis of this, is of the pre-trib rapture, as we've talked about this before, And throughout this chapter, he's going to say based upon a literal interpretation of the scripture. A literal interpretation of the scripture. And furthermore, a distinction between Israel and the church. These two groups are distinct. Israel and the church are distinct. That's why we have the two different programs. We have a program for Israel and a program for the church. The church was not seen in the Old Testament. He talks about the mystery. It's the mystery program. And this mystery program has to be completed. Once it's completed, then the 70th week of Daniel can continue. We had 69 weeks. The first 69 weeks of Daniel were literal. And the 70th week of Daniel is going to be literal as well. But that was interrupted by that period we know as the church. The age that we live in now. It has interrupted this. And he lists in this book, in this chapter, he lists 28 arguments of why there should be a pre-tribulational rapture. And a lot of the underpinnings of this, again, is the fact that you have a literal interpretation of Scripture, and you have a distinction between Israel and the church. I mean, one of the people that does not necessarily take the premill view. Alice, as we saw there in the book, he says, he agrees, you know, he admits, it says here on page 194, he says, if the literal method of interpretation of the scripture be the right method, premillennialism is correct. So when you interpret the scripture in a literal method, then you get the premillennial view. However, if you interpret the scripture in an allegorical way or spiritual way, then you could come up with any type of interpretation perhaps you may want. But it's important for us to understand the fact of a literal interpretation. He mentions here on page 194, he says, it can easily be seen that the literal method of interpretation demands a pre-tribulation rapture of the church. And he makes this observation. A lot through this chapter, he's contrasting, comparing the post-mill, the pre-mill, and the mid-trib views. He says the post-trib must either interpret the book of Revelation as historical or as spiritual. In other words, when he says here about historical, he's talking about the fact that the things in Revelation have already happened as historical account.
70 AD.
But sometimes the preterists take that view. And there's all sorts of odd views that are coming into coming to the light when you spiritualize something or when you take something as already happened. See, prophecy, we wouldn't want to say the people that lived in the Old Testament, it would be wrong for them to say the prophecy about the first advent if that had already happened. The first advent of Christ. That'd be wrong for them to say that. And see, if the scripture is consistent, or since the scripture is consistent, we have to understand that since the first advent, all the prophecies about the first advent were true and were fulfilled literally. Even so, must all the prophecies of the second advent be true and be fulfilled literally. That's why it's important for us to interpret the scripture literally, not just in the realm of prophecy, but in all things. Now, the second argument that he uses to support the pre-trib view is as far as actually the nature and the composition of the 70th week of Daniel. As we saw from our quiz, you know, the mid-trib viewers, they break it up into two parts. From our quiz and from last week, they break it up into two parts. The first part is for the church. The second part is for Israel. With that, that creates all sorts of problems because you have an overlapping. And this, when you overlap the two things, as he pointed out in the last chapter, his observation about the 144,000, how the 144,000, if they are there in the first part, and in that part, in hermeneutic of the mid-tribbers, if that is for the church, then this 144,000, when the church is taken away, you would think that they too would be taken away. Which is not the case. That they're there. The two witnesses, 144,000, there are to be witnesses for the primary audience for Israel. For Israel. It's going back. It's reverting back. The time of the law was suspended temporarily until the 70th week is completed. And so the very nature of the 70th week lends us to believe that the pre-trib view is the view for us to take. Now, the third out of 28 of his reasons why the pre-trib view should be accepted was as far as how this, the scope of the 70th week, the nature of the 70th week, the nature of the tribulation period. Yes, we have it. We have there. We do identify the part. There are two sections of the tribulation. There's the first part of it and the second part of it. Sometimes that second part of the tribulation is called the Great Tribulation, because in that point is when we have God's judgment being very obvious. We have, first of all, we have the covenant being broken. The peace treaty, the seven-year peace treaty the Antichrist makes with Israel is broken. And furthermore, then we have, not only we have the wrath of the Antichrist coming upon the inhabitants of the earth, but we have the wrath of God coming upon the earth as well. And so there's these two things that are happening at the same times. And so he mentions wrath, he mentions indignation, he mentions punishment, he mentions hour of trial. He mentions about six or seven, maybe eight things that talk about some specific type of judgment. And this would not be characteristic of things that would be coming upon the church. Now again, we will have trials, we will have tribulations, but not in the sense of Daniel's 70th week, not that tribulation. Tribulation is different. You have to take the context of what these different words mean in Scripture. And so what his observation is we have this wrath. The church is not going to be here for wrath. The church is not going to be being judged by God. If you notice over there, page 196, he says the church could not have been in the first 69 weeks of this prophecy. That was Old Testament. The church was not present there. And therefore, that conclusion would be it cannot and it will not be in the 70th week of prophecy. If you look at what Kelly says over there on page 96, Kelly says, the great tribulation, out of which a multitude of Gentiles emerge, but that both Jacob and the Gentiles are totally distinct from the Christians or the church. You see, there's a distinction. We must keep a distinction between the two groups. There will be tribulation saints, but they are different than the church. They resemble like Old Testament saints, because we have effectively the saints that are under the law. Daniel's 70th week is resumption of the time of law. Israel will be experiencing this. And the idea, when you look at the scope, the purpose for the tribulation period is for Israel. That's who that's who the tribulation is intended for. It's intended for Israel. Now, as far as he lists here he looks at the purpose of the 70th week. He has got two of them, two different purposes. Bill, please read Revelation 3:10 for me. Revelation 3:10.
Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth.
Okay, now notice it talks about them that dwell upon the earth. Now, this is not referencing the church. Them that dwell on the earth. You have to have a distinction, again, between Israel and the church. Now, if we notice near the bottom of page 197, he says, since the Father never sees the church accepting Christ, he never sees the church accepting Christ perfected in him, This period can have no reference to the church. For the true church does not need to be tested to see if her faith is genuine. See, the we have there's different, or there's our, we are in Christ, those of us who are believers, who have been washed in the blood of the Lamb, we are in Christ. We've been declared righteous. When God looks at us, he looks through Christ. Now granted, our status is maybe different. We obviously sin, but God sees us as Christ. So what his point he's trying to make is that when God looks during this judgment thing, he's looking at something that needs to be judged. And the church would not necessarily be in that company. Yes, the church needs discipline. We as Christians, we as children of God, we need to be disciplined. But as far as this judgment that's being talked about, as far as for the tribulation time period, this is not for the church. That's why the church is going to be taken away prior to this happening. Now, as far as the second purpose of the annual 70th week, Mr. Warren, please read Malachi chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. Malachi 4, 5 and 6.
Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city, and setteth him on the pinnacle of the temple, and saith unto him, If thou be the Son of God, oh, that's Matthew. It's not on here.
Oh, I didn't make the list. Okay, I'm sorry.
We can look it up.
Look it up. Want to look it up, Tammy, please? I'm sorry. I left it off the list. I'm trying to get you mixed up. I'm sorry.
What's the date on the top?
It's Matthew 4, 5, and 6. I have here.
What date do you have?
December 4th.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the date it should be, I think.
Where are we?
We're on page 197. I'm looking for Malachi chapter 4.
I was just trying to see what
it is. Okay, Malachi 3:16, but not...
Okay, so 5 and 6. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse.
All right, thank you. You see, the purpose of the Messiah, as we're reminded in verse 198, probably on page 198, is to make ready a people concerning the coming of Elijah, which we have in the sign of Israel, the Lord, you know. This is the coming of Elijah. The Lord was showing to his disciples that John the Baptist had this ministry for preparing the people for him. John the Baptist was a forerunner for the Lord Jesus Christ. And so if we look at the fifth support, 5 out of 28, as far as, again, this unity of the 70th week, there is a unity. In the 70th week, it's for. I'm sorry. You're looking for the. I think it got left off. I didn't get the verse on the piece of paper. I'm sorry.
What was it in the Bible?
Malachi 4.
Oh, 4.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So on over page 199, he says, the impossibility of including the church in the last half makes it equally impossible to include in the first half. So in other words, if the church doesn't belong in the last half of the tribulation, it does not belong in the first half, because there has that 70th week of Daniel is not to be broken in two pieces, one piece for the church, one piece for Israel. And so if someone is arguing the church cannot go through that second half, well, it can't go through the first half either, because it has to, the unity of the 70th week of Daniel. Yes, there is a clear distinction in the first half and the second half, but that is all related to Israel, and it's not related to the earth. Not related to the church, rather. Not related to the church. Now, as far as the nature of the church itself, you know, it's composed of, and this is where it's sometimes confusing what he's saying in this chapter here. That the church is composed of believers, and he's going to talk about a true church and a professing church. Now, he did talk about profession. Somebody makes a profession of faith. But we have there's a true church. He's going to talk about a professing church. The professing church is a phony church. You know, it's not really a true church. It's not the true church.
Catholic church.
For example, one of them, yes. I don't even like using the word church associated with it. But in other words, he's talking about the two groups. He says there's a distinction between the two. He says on page 199, the true church is composed of all those in the age who have received Christ as Savior, over against the professing church, composed of those who make a profession of receiving Christ. In other words, it's a false profession. And so, but the bottom line is, those who receive Christ as Savior are part of the true church. And there's only one church. There's only one way to heaven. There's only one way to God. There are not many ways. There are not many gods. There's just one God. One God and one God only. And it's only through the Lord Jesus Christ that we can have that salvation. Mr. Warren.
In Malachi, it speaks about, I will send Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. That would be the tribulation. But what Elijah is this?
Well, I think...
Oh, the original Elijah will be there, right?
Right. That's what we believe. Some believe that he's one of the two witnesses.
And
furthermore, yes, and furthermore, we have the fact of John the Baptist being like Elijah, who is the forerunner of the Lord Jesus Christ. Tammy, had a thought?
Well, it does sort of seem like he's saying he's a picture of Elijah, and he could have, I mean, had Israel received him, I mean, a lot of people asked, is this Elijah, or is this, you know, who are you? Mm-hmm. Are you Elijah? Mm-hmm. Are you the Christ? Then there was a reason for it, because, mm-hmm. you know, it was the Lord's first coming, so.
Yes. So, yes. Mm-hmm.
I don't know if this has anything to do with this, but the Jewish people, I found this out a few years ago, when they have the Passover, whatever they have, even the unbelieving Jews, they have a chair for Elijah.
They do. It's part of their...
I think he's going to come.
It's part of the tradition.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
That's part of the tradition. That's right.
The children go look for Elijah. I didn't know that until just recently.
Now, that is an interesting aspect of about their custom of their Passover, which is a commemoration of a remembrance of what happened in Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he says the rapture will remove who make a profession in Christ, but only those who have been born again and have received him, received his life. The unbelieving portion of the visible church, together with the unbelievers in the nation Israel, will go into the tribulation period. So, again, the people who are not part of the body of Christ, the people who have not trusted Christ as Savior, those people are the ones that are going to enter in and go through the tribulation period. You know, we have these different characteristics of who Christ is in relationship to the church, he mentions here. And another, the seventh principle of the pre-tribulation rapture is the concept of the church as a mystery. And we talked about this several chapters ago, about the church being a mystery. Over on page 201, he states, it was no mystery that God was going to provide salvation for the Jews, nor that the Gentiles would be blessed in salvation. This whole mystery program was not revealed until after the resurrection, rather after the rejection of Christ by Israel. That's when the mystery program was revealed. After the rejection, after the rejected Christ on the cross of Calvary. This is when salvation was provided to the Gentiles. And he continues on page 201, right there in the middle. It must logically follow that the mystery program must itself be brought to a conclusion before God can resume his dealing with the nation Israel. Now, eighth principle, 8 of 28. Again, the distinction between Israel and the church. Schaefer gives 24 areas in which the church is distinct from Israel and how Israel is distinct from the church. There's 24 of them. He lists right here in pages 201 and 202. He says, near the bottom of page 202, he says, these clear contrasts, which are the distinctions between Israel and the church, make it impossible to identify the two in one program, which is necessary to do if the church goes through the seventh week. As far as another point, the doctrine of imminency, meaning Christ can come back at any time. Over on page 203, the church was told to live in light of imminence concerning the Lord's, to translate them to his presence. Let's look at some of these verses here. Anna, you want to read John 14, verses 2 to 3, please? There's a sheet right there.
I'm sorry. I'm causing a delay. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also.
See, he's preparing a place for us. Mrs. Grummer, read Acts 1:11, please. I got the sheet there. It should be on your Bible verse sheet. Acts 1:11. As soon as Jacob takes you off mute, that'll be easier to hear, perhaps. Are you still there, Mrs. Grummer? Maybe not. Bill, you read Acts 1:11.
Which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? The same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven.
All right, Mr. Warren, 1 Corinthians 15, 51 and 52.
Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed.
All right, thank you. Mom, Philippians 3:20, please.
3:20, for our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look to the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ.
And Tammy, Colossians 3:4?
3:4?
Yeah, I guess I missed that.
No, it's here.
It's there, okay.
When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then ye shall also appear with him in glory.
Mrs. Grummer, are you still there?
Oh, sorry, I had put on mute, and then I went to get some socks and something on my feet because it's cold.
Okay. That's 1 Thessalonians 1:10, please. Yeah, it's we don't want you to freeze in that 70-degree weather there, Jacob.
First Thessalonians 1:10,
I'm sorry. Thank you. 1 Thessalonians 1:10.
And to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come.
All right, and Jacob, 1 Timothy 6:14, please. I didn't read James 5:8, Tim.
Okay. James 5:8. Be ye also patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh.
And Bill, 1 Peter 3:3-4.
Whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair and wearing of gold or putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great peace. Our price, yeah.
Thank you. Now, you know, the
how that one fits with this, but it's okay. It's he's got it in his book.
That's just about mohairs.
Okay. Maybe especially 2 Peter. Let's want to look up 2 Peter real quick. Somebody, is there for me, Tammy? Can you do that, please?
2 Peter what?
2 Peter 3:3-4. We're trying to figure out why this is verses here. I'm sorry, I should have.
Knowing this first, and there shall come in the last days scoffers walking in their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation.
Now, thank you. That might be better. Now, the idea of any moment rapture, you know, it's something we should be looking forward to. We shouldn't say, well, this is something that's a new doctrine. And if you look at the this is a longer passage, like 10, 11 verses here in John 21. Turn to John 21. That's not in the sheet, but take a Bible. If there's a Bible there in the pew, and turn to John 21. We get each read a verse until we get to the end of the chapter. But beginning with the verse 15. Though, why don't you read John 21:15, and we'll go around the room 16, 17, and so forth until we get to verse 25. And there's something I want to note here as far as this is a conversation the Lord Jesus Christ had with his apostles right there on the shores, think of Galilee, prior to his ascension. So John 21, verses 15 and following, and Bill's going to start with verse 15.
So when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He hath unto him, yea, the Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my lambs.
In verse 16, 21:16.
He saith unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my sheep.
He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved, because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep.
All right, 18, Tammy.
Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not.
This spake he, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken, he said unto him, follow me.
Then Peter turned about, seeth the disciple whom Jesus loved, following, which also leaned on his breast at supper, and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? Go ahead, Mrs. Grammer, verse 21.
Peter seeth him, saith to Jesus, Lord, and what shall this man do?
Jesus saith unto him, if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow thou me.
Then went this saying abroad among the brethren that disciple should not die. Yet Jesus said unto him, he shall not die, but if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee?
Right, 24.
This is a disciple which testifieth of these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true.
And 25, please.
And there are also many other things which Jesus did, to which if they should be written, every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. Amen.
All right, so the context of verse 21, you know, the Lord Jesus Christ has been crucified. He's rose from the dead. He was seen by the 11. And there, seven of the disciples decided they wanted to go fishing. So they went fishing. They fished all night. They caught nothing. Lord Jesus Christ appears on the shore and says, children, have you any meat? This is earlier in the chapter. And they say, no. And he says, cast your nets on the, and he tells them what side. It's the right side. Or let's cast your net on the right side of the boat. And they did, and they caught over 150 fishes. And the point being, I brought this passage up to say that, okay, with Peter, Peter's predicted to die. He says, you're going to, you see, the Lord Jesus Christ told him you're going to die, and this is how you're going to die, a certain way. Now, Peter and John, of the two, you know, we noticed from the previous passage, I believe we learned that Peter was the older of the two. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. And John was the younger. And so Peter was going to die. So that's one point. Now, the people that are the anti-imminent people believe that, well, here's your verse. Well, if you keep on reading in the next paragraph, the next part of the chapter, we see here verses 21, 22, 23, talking about John. And I wonder if this is, I don't think it can be. We're talking about the Apostle John. And Peter says, don't be concerned about your question. Now, concerning John, he says, if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow me. So keep on doing what you're supposed to do, Peter. And it doesn't matter if I come, if John tarries before I come, meaning coming again for the second time, the meeting of the clouds, what is that to thee? So people misunderstood this and thought that, well, John wouldn't die until Christ came back. But the point is, the subjunctive mood was used. There was an if clause. If. And so that lends a possibility in John's lifetime, the Lord would have been able to come back if he so chose to come back. And so that's an idea about the imminence right here from this passage the Lord Jesus Christ was having with the apostles. Tammy?
Could we argue that Peter was already old? I mean, when thou art old, you know, I mean, why does that mean they argue that when he's going to be able to grow old to an old man.
But no, you're right. He was already old. Earlier on in either this chapter or the previous chapter, we have the fact that he mentions he stated as being old or older. Now, granted, older is a relative term. I understand that. But he could have already been old.
Well, the point maybe wasn't so much about him being old as
growing old.
It was the point was that someone was going to carry him and he was going to die.
Yes.
So, I mean, that could have been the next day.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. That's correct. It could have been.
The if clause is very important.
It is. The if clause is very important. You know, he mentions how Luther, Calvin, Knox, a couple other reformers, how they all were looking at imminence, how God was promising, how they believed God promised and taught imminence, the scriptures taught imminence. As far as the tenth principle, as far as the preacher rapture, as far as the work of the restrainer, the work of the restrainer is mentioned in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. This the restrainer is the Holy Spirit. In the bottom of page 204, he says, in other words, someone, in the Holy Spirit, is preventing the purpose of Satan from coming to culmination, and I will keep on performing this ministry until he's removed. So this is the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And it's the visible church that will be removed. Holy Spirit's ministry, he says in page 205, with removal of the church, he says, it should be noted the Holy Spirit does not cease his ministries with removal of the church, nor does he cease to be omnipresent with her removal. But the restraining ministry does cease. So the ministry of the restraining ministry of the Holy Spirit will stop. The 11th principle he brings out as far as for the purpose of the preacher of rapture is the necessity of an interval an interval. He says the church must be raptured to return instantly and immediately with the Lord to the earth. Not only does this deny the Greek word, nor does it require the interpretation, but certain events predicted for the church after her translation make such an interpretation impossible. In other words, the judgment seat of Christ, the presentation of the church to the church of Christ, and the marriage of the Lamb. I'm at page 205, near the bottom. Now, if near the bottom of page 205, it says, it is impossible to conceive of this event as taking place without the expiration of some period of time. The church is to be presented as a gift from the Father to the Son. And then he's got some thoughts by Schofield there. And it gives these the role of the church. You know, we have the idea of some of these events are taking place in heaven as the tribulation period is taking place here on the earth. That's the 70th week of Daniel. As those events are taking place here on the earth, we have certain events that are taking place in heaven. A 12th principle he lists here for the rapture, as far as the distinction between the rapture and the second advent. Just a second. The rapture, of course, is the meeting in the clouds. What Pentecost here, when he says the second advent, that's what he was referencing as far as when Christ comes back to the Mount of Olives. By Mr. Warren?
The point I was making before was the reason why there has to be a time, an interval there, because if you had the post-tribulation where you go up and down,
yes,
at the same
right.
time, there's no time for all this.
There's not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's why that's important, for having that interval of time.
When we talk about the interval of time, what's that?
The things we just listed, all those things have to take place.
Okay.
You know, the marriage supper of the Lamb.
Okay.
You know, the Bema. All these different things that have to take place.
Is there such a thing as no time there at all? Once we've been raptured, we step outside the limitations of time.
Possibly.
That's you have a valid point, Bill, as far as that's concerned. But as far as the fact of we have there's still time on Earth. Now, I don't understand what you're saying. I mean, the guy can do anything he wants to do. That doesn't violate his character. You know, Tammy, you have a thought about that or not?
I was just going to say what you were saying. As far as, you know, we only have 7 years before we return.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. The Lord. So, you know, I mean, it's not so much the time in heaven, but the time on earth.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's the time of our earth. Now, he lists here a distinction between the first phase of the second advent and the second phase of the second advent, or the rapture and the second advent. He calls phase one of the second coming of the rapture, which is fine. That's a good term to use. But still, Christ is coming back a second time, meeting the clouds. We meet him in the clouds. And then we have the actual physical return to the earth, what Pentecost refers to as the second advent, second phase two of the second advent, second coming. And he lists 17 distinctions here on pages 206 and 207 of the two. You know, you can't get the two mixed up. You got to keep them straight. And, you know, he lists these 17 distinctions of the two on these pages. Now, another point that he brings out, this is his, I guess, his 13th point, his supporting point as far as the 420 elders. Who are these 420 elders? They're mentioned in Revelation 4:4. You have your verse sheet there, Joe, handy? Want to read Revelation 4:4, please?
Is that Revelation 4:4?
Yes, please.
And round about the throne were 24 seats, and upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold.
Okay, so this is the picture. Around the throne of God, there's 24 seats, 24 seats. Now, the Greek word behind the word seat is thronos, and some modern Bibles translate these words as thrones. seats is just as good a word as anything else. But this point being is the fact of who is on these thrones, who is on these seats that are on the throne. Now, there are various interpretations, but a legitimate one would be this represents the church, the presence of the church in heaven. And so if the church is in heaven, when judgment is taking place in the earth, the church is not omnipresent. It can only be present in one place at a time, either here on earth or in heaven, as far as a corporate body. Understand that when the believer dies, that are part of the church, they absent from the body, present with the Lord. But as far as he's bringing up the points in Revelation 4, as far as the principle of these elders who are, and again, perhaps later on in the book we'll discuss other possibilities, but we know there's one proper interpretation. There's several thoughts of who these are, but if it definitely is the church, representative of the church, then the church is in heaven during this time period. Now, his 14th point...
Excuse me, we're talking about 7 years, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. That's correct. We're trying to demonstrate the fact, the absence of the church from the earth, because they're present in heaven, right, here in this passage in Revelation. Then the 14th point, he says, he talks about the problem behind 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. Tammy, you want to read 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 13 and 18, please?
But I would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words.
Now notice what he says on page 209. You know, as far as he's trying to get into the mind of the church in Thessalonica. Now, of course, we know that the book of Thessalonians, it's in scripture, it's inspired word of God. But he says here, if the Thessalonians had believed that the church would be going through the 70th week, they would have rejoiced that some of their brethren had missed this period of suffering and were with the Lord without experiencing the outpouring of wrath. If the church were going through the tribulation, it would be better to be with the Lord than to await the events of the 70th week.
What number is that?
That's on page 209.
Letter N.
This is 14, his 14th point. Yeah. Now, the 15th point he makes, letter O, he says, the announcement of peace and safety. Mrs. Grummer, please read 1 Thessalonians 5:3. Thank you. Now notice over on page 210, he says, if the church were in the 7th week, there would be no possibility that during the period when the believers were going to be persecuted by the beast to be an unprecedented degree, such a message could be preached and find acceptance to the men would be lulled into complacency. So, The idea of church going through the tribulation, these verses are trying to demonstrate the fact that it's not expected. The church is not expected. They weren't expecting to go through the 70th week of Daniel. They were not expecting that. Now the 16th point he makes, this is point letter P, the relation to the church to governments. He says, Near the bottom of page 210, he says, because of the relationship of the church to governments in the age, and because of the satanic control of governments in the seventh week, the church must be delivered before the satanic government manifests itself. So again, we know that the government of Antichrist is going to be satanic. I mean, we may think it's the governments, some of the governments today are satanic. Some of them may be heavily influenced by that. And there's what's 190, what's the number of countries we have here in the world? Do you remember?
It's in flux.
It's in flux.
And then it depends on who recognizes what country and so forth okay. and so on, and it's very complicated.
So less than 200, right?
No, I would say it's between 190 and maybe 230. But I
okay.
could be totally wrong.
Okay, so we have less than 250 governments in this kind, in this world.
Pastor Dan?
Yes, Jacob.
Yeah, we just declared sovereignty on this property.
Okay, so you're your own government.
Yes.
Okay.
That's a good idea. I think I'm going to do that too.
Is it the government with or without socks?
No, with socks today, because it is a polar breeze.
Okay, that's good. So that just increased our number of governments. But the principle is when you have the time of Daniel's seventh week, this is not going to be a single country. It's going to be a worldwide, something which has never been seen before, a worldwide government. You know, we should be repulsed by the term one new world order. You know, that's pointing right towards something that's going to happen. We don't know when it's going to happen, but still, it's a repulsive term that the 43rd president of the United States has used. Probably the 41st president. No,
the
43rd.
George Bush,
41st president. Thank you. The 41st president of the United States had used often. Mr. Warren.
I believe that Obama is pushing toward that because he's a world. That's what he wants.
You know, but it's this again. This is not necessarily any sign we're stating, but this is the tendency of humanity. But when Antichrist comes, when Antichrist is present, then and only then will this world government take place. The covenant he makes, the seven-year peace treaty he makes. I mean, even the United States doesn't want to have peace with Israel, at least the present administration. And so it's going to be something. I'm talking about the government. I'm talking about Washington. I'm talking about the people in the White House. The White House. That's what I'm talking about. The White House doesn't want. I'm not talking about the building.
I understand.
You know.
I was just clarifying because there are, I mean, I just want people to know that, you know, we would support Israel as
yes,
our government.
Yes, we do support Israel. Probably the majority of Americans support Israel. Bona fide, true Americans, red-blooded Americans support Israel. Now, there are people that are not, that are in America who are not really Americans. But that's where we're behind schedule. So his 17th point, number Q, he says, the silence concerning the tribulation. You know, it says, we talk about, the Bible talks about there's persecution, and then there's some of the things that happen. We see here, over on page 211, the Bible says, I'm not the Bible, on page 211, we have here, Pentecost says, they would not prepare for the persecution common to all, and neglect outpouring of wrath in which the believer would need special help and assistance if he were to be in it. In this connection, Schofield writes. And so Schofield is trying to explain these things. As far as what is being said, he says, he talks about the upper chamber, the upper room discourse. These things are not mentioned in the upper room discourse.
I lost my place.
On page 211. On page 211.
Thank you.
Inasmuch the persecution of the age and wrath of the seventh week vary in kind and character, not just in intensity, it is not sufficient to say that if one is prepared for the lesser, he will also be of the greater. The silence of the epistles, which will leave the church unprepared for the tribulation, argues for her absence from that period altogether. From that period altogether. Now, you see what the, his point is trying to make is the epistles are not necessarily talking about the church going through this 70th week of Daniel. We're not talking about it at all. Now, again, he makes the 18th point. This is number R, letter R. The message of the two witnesses. Tammy, read Revelation 11:3, please.
And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth.
Now, these two special witnesses are sent to Israel. We see over at page 211. Their ministry is accompanied by signs to substitute the divine origin of the message according to the Old Testament prophets, use of signs. The substance of their preaching is not revealed, but its content may be seen as suggested by the clothing of those messengers. They are said to be clothed with sackcloth, which is defined by, and then we give a definition of what how sackcloth is defined. But as far as, this is the clothing of the Old Testament prophets, sackcloth.
Elijah,
you know, John the Baptist, and so forth. Over page 211. Yes.
Oh, I thought it was interesting when it said it was made of sackcloth.
Yes.
Because I always thought it was made of burlap bags.
Okay, so comment further.
Well, I always thought it was burlap bags, but here it says it's sometimes can be hair of animals and like a material to clinging to the person like a sack, which went to be worn by mourners, penitent supplements. So I don't know. I don't have anything more to say.
Okay, Max, I'm glad you... So it's not burlap, you know.
But today I think it's burlap, but okay. I always thought it was burlap because evidently I've seen somebody wear sackcloth.
Mm-hmm. But right. It has the same idea.
You probably know that.
Right. Same idea. Same principle. Go ahead, Jacob. Your thought. Yes, that's right. You're right.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
Yeah.
Did they mention about John the Baptist in here? It's been a long time since I read it.
He mentioned John the Baptist earlier on, higher up on page 211.
Okay.
Now notice what he says here at page 212. He says, it may be concluded from their distinctive dress that the two witnesses are announcing the same message as John did, our repentance, because of the king is coming. So that's over page 212. Now, a 19th point he makes here, this is S, the destiny of the church. No one would deny that the destiny of the church is a heavenly destiny. Our promises, our expectations are heavenly in character. See, this is what the promise we have. You know, near the bottom of page 212, he states, this can only be indicated that the saved during the seventh week to go into the millennial must have been saved after the termination of the program for the church. There will be tribulation saints, men and women who are going to be turned to Christ during the tribulation time period. And these people who live the persecution of the Antichrist, who survive that, they will enter into the millennium as human beings.
Did you say that again?
There's going to be an element of people who are going to be saved, or going to be delivered, or going to turn to Christ during the tribulation time period. And those people are going to enter into the as human beings, and then never having died before, going to enter into the millennial time period. Yes?
May I ask a question?
Yes.
Because in Revelation 7, see if you have it here. Revelation 7, 15 or something, I think. It's S, oh, here. So 7:13 and 14, well, verse 14 says, and I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest, and he said unto me, which came out of great tribulation. They washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. My question is that, are they in heaven in that verse?
Yes, there'll be some martyrs.
And so they would be part of the church?
No, okay. Let me, I'm trying to answer, you're trying to identify who these people are in chapter 7.
Yes.
Okay. These are martyred tribulation saints. That's what I would say. That's what I would think.
So then they're resurrected.
They're not necessarily resurrected. They may have a temporary body. Just like
I'm saying they're resurrected at the end of the tribulation.
Yes. That's correct. Okay. Mm-hmm. Along with the Old Testament saints.
I didn't understand that before.
Okay. So since now think about it this way. Since we have the seventh week of Daniel is a continuation of a certain sense of, okay, you know, and so the tribulation saints and Old Testament saints fall into the same classification, I would say. And so that's why we have them being resurrected along with the saints of the Old Testament.
You said the new, say that again about the two things. I'm a little mixed up here from the parallel that went on.
Okay.
So there's,
Now the point being, Tammy was wondering, she was looking at Revelation 7, the passage there in Revelation 7, and she was wondering,
what are these that are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they?
Okay, and my answer that my observation about that verse is, this is referencing tribulation saints that have been martyred in the tribulation time period.
Okay.
And so I'm putting, we put the tribulation saints in the same classification. The saints in the 70th week of Daniel are in the same classification as saints in the 69th week of Daniel.
Okay,
the 69th week of Daniel preceded, you know, that was that point in time prior to the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so it's the church is the time of law is suspended. It's interrupted by the mystery church. And so we have the principle is we have a continuation of the time of law, just in a non-technical sense, perhaps in a technical sense, in a certain sense, but we have a continuation. The church has been removed. Now we have a resumption of God's timetable. 69th, the 69th week of Daniel has been suspended for a moment, for this interval of time known as the church. Then we have a resumption of this time period of Daniel's prophecy, and we have one more week left, a prophetic week. This prophetic week is the tribulation time period. Saints that die in the tribulation saints take on the same characteristics as Old Testament saints as far as the resurrection. And so this passage in Revelation 7, I believe, is referencing tribulation martyrs.
Amen.
And just a second, Jacob. Consequently, we'll have a resurrection of the Old Testament saints and the tribulation saints occurring at the same time prior to the millennium. So did that answer, start to answer your question?
I have another question, but okay. Let Jacob go first.
Jacob, your question. Your comment.
Well, yes, sir. I guess there would be a legitimate Hebrew roots movement then, because they'll be under the Jewish system against the believers that come in the tribulation, the tribulation saints.
The Old Testament saints. Because it's Old Testament. You're right, Jacob. Tammy, go to your next question.
Well, my other question was about verse 9. And I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. So there were Jews that were saved. There were Gentile ones that were saved that would appear in temporary bodies in heaven? Is that the idea?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's correct. I mean, based on Second Corinthians chapter 5.
Second Corinthians chapter 5, what does that say?
Yeah, the ones that are passed away before the tribulation also have a temporary
body. I mean, the point of a temporary body is the support for that would come from Second Corinthians chapter 5. I mean, without regard to the fact that if there's not a temporary body, but I would support the temporary body argument based upon a interpretation of, which I believe is an accurate interpretation of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, whereby we have longing to be clothed upon.
Can I read it?
Please read it, yes.
For we know that if our earthly house, so this tabernacle, be dissolved, we have a building of God, and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. You want me to read more?
Please do. Mm-hmm.
For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked.
Hi, thank you. And so that's why I'm using the word temporary body. Where there's a glorified body, but 2 Corinthians chapter 5 perhaps indicates the fact there may be a temporary body. An intermediate body. Temporary, intermediate, one of those two words. Intermediate body. And so we have here is his 20th point, which we are past, a little bit past our schedule here. But anyway, that he talks about the Laodicean church. He says, the church represents the final form of the professing church, which is rejected by the Lord and vomited out of his mouth. And so, you know, you can't have this principle be in place. You know, it's the Laodicean principle. And then he talks about the times of the Gentiles. You know, the elements in Revelation 11:2 makes this view unattainable. And then he talks about the remnant. You know, there's a remnant, but the remnant is referring to Israel is the remnant. You know, there's not a remnant of the church. You know, and then he talks about the 144,000. Have this 144,000. You can't have 144,000 without it being part of the church. Then he talks about the apostasy that's during that period, and you can't have apostasy depending how you define the word apostasy, you can't have that as part of the true church. And there are certain promises to the true church, that's the church of Bible-believing Christians, people who have trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior. And then he talks about this typology. He talks about Noah, Rahab, he talks about Lot. When talking about Lot, he talks about how Lot, you know, God was merciful to Sodom and Gomorrah. God was merciful to Lot. He brought Lot out of Sodom and Gomorrah before it was destroyed. And so consequently, that was judgment that came. You know, he talks about during the time of the flood, we had judgment that came. And the people that were saved, the people that were delivered, were the people that were in the ark. The people that were delivered, you know, Lot was delivered from Sodom and Gomorrah. Lot, his two daughters and his wife for a short period of time were delivered from the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. And so he says his final thought here in the bottom of page 218, and he says it should be borne in mind that it's not claimed that all arguments have the same importance of weight. The pre-tribulation doctrine is not based on these arguments, but rather they are considered as a cumulative evidence that the church will be delivered by rapture before the inception of Daniel's 70th week. So that's our lesson today on the pre-trib rapture view. And a lot of different views, a lot of different things you brought into. There are 28 different elements you brought into the fact of why we should interpret the scripture as there being a pre-tribulation rapture. So, Mrs. Grummer, some thoughts you have about this chapter.
Well, it's good. I really enjoyed reading this chapter. My son and I did.
Good.
Because it it's good to know these things. It's good to know what we've been reading too.
Yes.
But
mm-hmm.
This is very important.
Right. How about you, Jacob? Some thoughts you have? Any warm thoughts? Good.
I was thinking about something. You know that. Let me see here. I have marked something in my Bible. I know. Oh yeah, the thing I was talking about scoffing last time with that Second Kings. You know what? Only two of Lot's daughters came out. You know, the ones that were married didn't. I think it says here in.
That's right.
Genesis 19:14. And referring to what I said about the scoffing, you know, and then the children being eaten by the 10 she-bears when they were mocking Elisha.
Mm-hmm, that's right.
The false prophets of Bethel. And it says here, connected with that, Genesis 19:14, and Lot went out and spake to his sons-in-law, which married his daughters, and said, Up, get ye out of this place, for the Lord will destroy the city. But he seemed as one that mocked unto his sons-in-law. Then once didn't come out, and that's a good doctrine on separation also, I think.
Yep, it's very important. Good point, Jacob. Bill, how about you? Some thoughts you have about this chapter? A lot of thoughts.
Yeah, it's going to be a while before I digest all of this stuff. I've got to reread it some more. In fact, I have to actually start at the beginning of the book and go through it again.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot I don't really understand.
Right, that's right. Yeah, there's a lot. There's a lot here.
Yeah.
So you just as long as you understand something,
yeah.
Then you can build upon that, and then you look up the verses and try to build what you understand about the Word of God, and look at Him again, and maybe eventually the second time, and say, oh, I see what He's talking about. There's a lot of things that sometimes are a little bit abstract, and he's bringing in various other views to contrast a proper view. See, when you study, sometimes you do different studies, you want to know what someone else teaches, the wrong view, mm-hmm. the different wrong views of certain things, so they could also be appreciated of the right view. Mr. Warren, how about you?
I think this really gives weight and evidence mm-hmm. toward the pre-tribulationary rapture.
Yes,
because,
it does. Mm-hmm.
Because for so many reasons, there has to be a time between so that there could be the wedding of the church and that the church will not go through the tribulation because that is judgment. Mm-hmm. And the judgment is for the people on the earth. This brings this out very clearly. Is for the people of the earth and those that reject Christ. Mm-hmm. And that we will be in heaven during that time mm-hmm. because we are not subject to that tribulation. Then afterwards, we will come back with the Lord Jesus. We will have a new body, a new earthly, heavenly body,
mm-hmm.
eternal, but it's earthly so that we can reign with Christ on the earth. But this really brings out that there has to be a pre-tribulationary rapture for all this to occur. And so many of these points that are given in this book, boy, really give evidence to it, I think. Mm-hmm. And I was a little doubtful about, you know, where it all occurred. But I'm clear on
good.
It.
Good. Amen. How about you? Thoughts you have about this this chapter?
Well, I wrote thoughts down that I wondered who are the saved people. I was in reading this all. I guess I never thought about where the tribulation saints would go, I had to leave. I'm sorry. I had to be sure where your father was. I didn't know if he was outside or inside.
Okay.
And the people that are saved during the millennium after the tribulation is over. They're also saved like the Old Testament people.
Mm-hmm.
That was sort of when we were reading this, it was sort of a shock to me. I thought, I studied this all in Bible school, but I forgot everything. I've heard big charts on Revelation and all that stuff.
Right.
And I was just surprised that the Christians were not like the church Christians, the believers that are in the church, they're a different kind of believer. We're a different kind of believer. But all but through Christ. But I'm just rambling here because I'm trying to understand all this, and I had to leave the room.
Okay. Sorry, you're allowed to ramble to understand.
I know I'm not supposed to ramble. I'm supposed to understand.
But you don't, You can.
I'm not trying to contradict you. I'm just really confused on all this.
Okay, what do you understand?
Well, I am understanding it, but see, I guess I never really knew. I always thought when after Christ died on the cross and was buried and resurrected, I thought everybody from then on was saved like that. But now in reading this and all this, somewhere I didn't pick it up till now, that the church is raptured and gone and the people are saved, I've said this before, a different way. Is that wrong?
Well, in a sense, it's always based upon the blood of Christ.
Right.
Whether it's past, present, or future. It's always even looking forward to the cross or looking backwards to the cross.
Uh-huh.
And so the tribulation saints may not be part of the church because the church is taken away, but they'll be still part of God's family. They'll be safe in the redemption work of Calvary if they trust in what was done on the Calvary's cross. They'll be saved. They'll be born again and saved. They will not be part of the church.
Now, are we talking now about?
You're talking about tribulation saints. Tribulation saints and millennium saints.
Are they both saved the same way?
The term, as we talked about it in previous discussions, previous classes, the term church can be used in several different ways. In ecclesia, it could be used 10, 12 different ways in Scripture. You know, it's an assembly. But specifically, when I use the word church, I'm talking about a specific class of people who are part of that class of people who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior. I mean, it's not proper for us, I don't think, to call people in the Old Testament as part of the church. We want to keep the distinction between Israel and the church. And we have the churches in this mystery time period we're in right now. And so in the tribulation time period, there's no longer any church proper, church specific. There may be a church in general, if you want to use the term loosely. But I won't use the term. I don't want to use the term loosely.
An organization.
The church.
The church.
Yeah.
Yesterday.
Yes, Jacob.
Yeah. Remember when we were studying the part about Matthew 13?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And again, this was mentioned in this chapter. The kingdom of heaven is what they'd be considered.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's right.
And the kingdom of God is what Jesus said to Nicodemus, unless you be born again.
Mm-hmm. Right.
This being all believers from eternity that have lived in faith towards the coming of Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right.
They had other stuff, but it was still not. Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's good, Jacob. Thank you. And sometimes those terms are used interchangeably. You know, but I know I understand what you're saying. Joel, some thoughts you have about this chapter.
Well, so what was saying? I know what you're saying, and, you know, thank you for explaining. But, yeah, of course, you know, be saved by Christ's shed blood and the blood of the Lamb, no matter mm-hmm. what time period you're saved,
right.
Whether it's before the rapture, which is, you know, part of the church, or it's after the rapture, which is part of the tribulation, and when the tribulation saints will be saved.
Mm-hmm.
I understood quite a bit of this, but I was, you know, quite exhausted this week, so I just, you know, a little trouble formulating my thoughts here, even though I thought it was a good chapter. But due to my physical exhaustion, and the length of the chapter, I just said, oh, I have to read it for Friday. And usually I'm not, you know,
a lot to it.
And I just, you know, my exhaustion was getting in the way. Mm-hmm. And, spirit's willing, but the flesh is weak, you know, and that's an example of it for me right there.
Mm-hmm.
But to show how far God will go in his mercy, you know, and reemphasizing or reinforcing on page 218 about, you know, when it says on the uppermost paragraph, the presence of one righteous man prevented the outpouring of their judgment on the city of Sodom, how much more will the presence of the church on earth prevent the outpouring of divine wrath until after her removal? I mean, it's amazing how God has his mercy. And then, you know, the fact that his Holy Spirit as the restrainer will not allow certain things to occur until certain time periods or a certain time frame, until after the rapture, where the full wrath of God will be coming out by the seals, the trumpets, this, that, and all the other things, the bowls, et cetera, et cetera. But what else was I going to say? The fact that we have the Holy Spirit, if we become saved, the Holy Spirit is dwelling in each and every one of us to guide us, to draw us with comfort, to reassure us, to remind us of our salvation, and you know, that we're righteous through Christ. It's nothing that we have to do via works or anything, but just by Christ shed blood, and that's it. And not just getting you know, new bodies, you know, like in the twinkling of the eye, rapture occurs and everything, but having the new bodies and being able to come back as co-reigners, almost co-reigner, whatever, mm-hmm. with Christ in the millennium mm-hmm. for 1,000 years, it's amazing. It's like an extra treat there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, our salvation is treat enough on earth, and then
right.
being given the raptured body, the perfect body, this is like a second treat. And then, I mean, there's all these other blessings mm-hmm. that follow between all these things.
Yes, mm-hmm. that's right.
We're studying, and to be with him in the millennium is just, you know, be able to is it the Battle of Armageddon, in which we come back with the Lord to judge the unbelievers?
That's right.
That's mm-hmm. it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, all of that, it's like we don't deserve our salvation, much less being able to come back and judge with Christ himself
mm-hmm.
and
that's right.
reign with Christ in the millennium and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Where everything will be perfect. Humans,
right.
animals, everything.
mm-hmm. yeah. How about you, Tammy? Some thoughts you have?
Well, I just want to say I appreciate what Jill just
yes.
said. Mm-hmm. So that was a blessing. But I was thinking about what Mom said about, you know, and you were talking about with reference to Israel and the church.
Mm-hmm.
And wouldn't that be the spiritual kingdom? Because it says this kingdom can not be entered in apart from a new birth. I mean, it's composed of the elect of all the ages.
Yes.
So that's what all these people mm-hmm. of all these different time periods, that maybe they're the Gentile nations, or maybe they're Israel, that believing Israel, or
mm-hmm.
believing Gentile nations, or maybe they're the church.
Right.
But as far as this chapter, I really like the chronology that mm-hmm. he's got.
Yes.
Yeah, number X. That's really
mm-hmm.
very, very helpful and very interesting. So I've never seen that before as far as, you know, with the seals, the trumpets, other than the previous chapter, he did mention
right.
briefly,
mm-hmm.
but to actually see him explain the whole chronology of mm-hmm. the Revelation was very interesting. And then also how he talked about the Church of Laodicea, that was very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I never really thought of it in that vein as far as being a professing but not possessing church, which clearly it
mm-hmm.
it is. I mean, otherwise, and the great blessing on the Church of Philadelphia, and the distinction between that and, you know, the Church of Laodicea,
mm-hmm.
well, very interesting. And, you know, the book was, or this chapter was filled with all sorts of things mm-hmm. like that. So, a lot to review.
Yes, that's right. How about you, Anna? What do you have?
I should have thoughts, but it's just, I sometimes get a little lost, and because sometimes, I don't know.
Okay, sorry.
It's just, lost. There's lots of things, like, that we're drawing from, and sometimes it's easier to look at one passage of scripture. I guess it's easier for me to look at one passage of scripture really detailed sometimes than, I don't know what I'm saying. I'm trying to say something, but it's not making any sense, so I'll stop.
Okay.
Well. Sounds good to me.
All right, well, thank you. Any more thoughts or questions or observations? Just go ahead. What's your thought?
I just wanted to say nothing to do with teaching, but when we were in Dallas, when Dad
yes.
was at seminary there, within walking distance,
mm-hmm.
if you walk far and you didn't mind, was Schofield Memorial Church,
mm-hmm.
which was named after Schofield, referenced by a woman. I guess a lot of times people, especially in the South, they name churches after men.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So like First Baptist or Trinity or Calvary, they named it like mm-hmm. Daniel Waite Baptist Church.
Mm-hmm.
So it's so amazing to me that we studied that exactly
mm-hmm.
in Bible school. But I kind of accepted it.
Mm-hmm.
But since I got away from it,
right.
But that really brings it back, mm-hmm. and I know good. What I believe now.
Super. Amen. That's good.
Good. Praise mm-hmm. God.
Yeah. More thoughts, comments, observations about this chapter?
We liked it a lot.
Oh, good. Thanks, Jacob. It's,
We should, a few people started coming, and then they have dropped off. It is very difficult to read and stuff.
It is, yes.
But mm-hmm. we have to stick with it.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you're teaching, even if they don't read it, you do very, very well teaching.
Okay, well, praise the Lord.
Very good. I don't know which is well or good, but.
That's not the class.
It's very hard to teach this.
An English class teaches very well.
Very well.
All right, so. Okay, that's fine. I'll have the quizzes I'll have for you on Sunday, Lord willing. Quizzes and the verses I'll have ready for you on Sunday. I should have had them today, but I don't have them today. So we'll have them on Sunday. Yes, Mrs. Grammer?
I don't understand everything I read,
okay.
But I understand most of it.
Good.
I ask a lot of questions, and sometimes I still don't get it, but mm-hmm. I'll get it.
Well, if you get,
wonderful,
yeah.
Wonderful chapter.
If you get cold feet, just put some socks on. Okay. All right, Joe, go ahead.
Clarity, at least for me, yeah. I think the class as
yeah.
well, but
good.
Clarity on points that maybe originally I didn't understand.
Right. That's good. That's good, Joel. Yeah.
Well, we got so mixed up with the wrong ways, you know, hearing the wrong ways.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
answering the questions on the wrong ways. It did mix up what I believe, but it was confusing. I didn't know why we had to study that, but I did study.
Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to.
Well, I think it was helpful.
It's not your fault.
It helps you have a better perspective
right.
of your own.
Yeah, when
beliefs.
You're reading, I don't believe that. You know, that's.
Yeah, so if somebody comes along that has the different position.
You can identify.
Or they want to modify a certain position. No, that's right. You're right, Tammy. You modify it. You identify it.
When you listen to the radio,
mm-hmm.
I mean, there's all kinds in it. Can get you so confused.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But if you just go back to this,
mm-hmm.
you know what you believe
mm-hmm.
in yourself, and I think we should stick to it.
Mm, that's right. Jill.
Sometimes the critics of the true doctrine, the critics that are presented in the book and their arguments, tend to ramble on so much or so long that, I mean, I personally can get confused and say, what was the point? What was the main thing? Or I have to go back to this other point or subpoint on, you know, like I said, I know I don't believe this. Where's it going? It's rambling too much.
I know.
Disagree with it, but you go back to what we really believe in.
Mm-hmm.
It's firmer.
Right, that's right.
Solidified.
That's good.
Especially that fellow in the afternoon on WVCH, the answer man.
Okay, yeah, he's
wow.
preterist, yeah.
Oh,
when it comes to the biblical prophecy, he's preterist. He believes.
It's better not to
yeah.
listen to him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. yeah. All right. Mr. Warren, would you please close in prayer?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that we have the truth and that we have to understand it and help us to understand it because
mm-hmm.
there's so much in the Bible. It's so infinite in knowledge and understanding. And I pray that you would guide us in all truth, that we may not be misunderstood standing of what we believe. And I thank thee for this teaching, and I thank thee for the book, and that it really goes into it and brings out the verses that bring out the truth. And I pray that you would help us to really understand it and to be able to present it to people as you have taught us. And I pray that you would bless us tonight, today, and bless our week, that we may serve you with all our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.